What do you think the future holds? It's a question we all ask, because having some idea of what's up ahead is essential. For individuals planning their lives, businesses making investments, or governments setting policy. Yet given how important accurate prediction is, we're surprisingly bad at it. Just look at how often we've been blindsided by events we could or should have seen coming. For much of history, this could be blamed on the questionable places we looked for guidance. But today, in an age where superstition has mostly been replaced with science, it really seems like we should be doing better. So is there some way of using scientific thinking to improve our powers of prediction? That's a great idea, but not without problems. Take meteorology. Even with cutting-edge algorithms and terabytes of data, weather forecasts are only reliable up to a couple of weeks. Beyond that, there are just too many tiny variables that influence the outcome. And if forecasts involving air pressure, ocean currents, and solar radiation sound tricky, imagine the headache involved in political or economic predictions, which are based on something far more complex and inconsistent: human beings. Sadly, we can't simply feed social and economic data into a computer to get a readout of the future. But perhaps there's another way to make prediction more scientific. For example, scientists run experiments, so why not ask lots of people for predictions on lots of topics and see what actually works? That was the idea behind ACE, a five-year forecasting tournament held by US military intelligence, which posed questions on everything from currency valuations to border disputes to nuclear tests. Five teams entered, but one demolished the competition. The Good Judgment Project, led by psychologist Philip Tetlock. After 20 years studying political judgment, he'd concluded that most experts, whose prophecies were often treated as gospel, were in fact roughly as accurate as a dart-throwing chimpanzee. So when he took part in ACE, he recruited thousands of curious amateurs, gave them basic training, and put them to work, with striking results. His best performers were almost twice as accurate as the control group, and even beat professionals with access to classified information, prompting Tetlock to dub his A-team Superforecasters. So what makes Superforecasters super? You might think genius-level intelligence, statistical wizardry, or a wild imagination. But Tetlock insists that really it's just down to simple mental habits, ones that go against how people usually think about the future. Ask a random friend whether Apple's stock price will fall in the next 6 months, and they'll probably answer yes or no based on what they already think about the company. Reasonable enough. But once they've made their guesstimate, try presenting them with a contradictory argument, and a quirk of human psychology is likely to kick in. Rather than changing our minds in line with the evidence, we tend to become defensive, which in this case means doubling down on a prediction that was never that well-founded in the first place. Superforecasters, however, think differently at every step, beginning with a step back. Ask them about Apple stock, and they'll first look at similar companies and the market as a whole, which provide a base rate to calibrate their expectations. Only then will they look at Apple, and rather than rely on impressions, they'll gather data, which only takes a little Googling. But they won't stop there. While most people reject opposing viewpoints, superforecasters actively seek them out, then adjust their own views accordingly, and not just once. They'll keep updating their beliefs, steadily zeroing in on the most likely outcome, which they'll express not as a simple yes or no, but as a probability. Finally, whether proven right or wrong, they'll check to see if their reasoning held up and whether there's anything they could learn for next time. Now, this might all sound rather obvious. Rely on data rather than snap judgments, think in shades of gray, be open-minded and self-reflective. But that's exactly the point, because if we're really so bad at making predictions and the principles for doing better are really so straightforward, then improvement should be easy. That doesn't mean superforecasting is a foolproof algorithm which guarantees you'll never be surprised again, just that it's a step in the right direction, an effective way of improving our foresight in the short term while avoiding overconfident pronouncements about the long term. Speculating about the distant future can be fun, but it's not a vital skill. Whereas having a good sense of what's around the corner and how it might affect us as workers, savers, and citizens definitely is. And that's precisely where we all stand to benefit from thinking like superforecasters. In a nutshell, that means thinking like a scientist, or at least as scientists ideally should. Looking at all the evidence, engaging with criticisms, and above all, not valuing a pet theory above the truth. So even if we can never forecast far-off events as accurately as tomorrow's thunderstorm, adopting superforecasters' habits of thought can help all of us weather what's to come.